The Tokener explains a beginner's guide to developing smart contracts using the Solidity programming language on top of the Ethereum blockchain platform. In this first episode, I will introduce Ethereum and the concepts smart contracts and Solidity to you. First, some background info about this guide. This guide will be a practical guide to quickly develop your own smart contracts. As such, we will not go into a lot of theoretical background about Ethereum. There's a lot of interesting stuff there and we highly recommend that you check it out. But in this guide, we will only give you some overview information, just enough to easily get you started and understanding how you can interact with it. It really helps if you already have some prior knowledge if you want to use this guide. Maybe you've already used a different programming language before. And also, we will be using a terminal command line interface in some of the later episodes. So if you know your way around on the command line, it also really helps to understand what's going on. Alright, let's start with a little bit of background information and history of how Ethereum came to be, because this really helps to understand how you can use it. In 2008, Satoshi Nakamoto published a white paper, an academic paper, about Bitcoin. And Bitcoin was the first software system that allowed to perform payments in a decentralized way digitally, and was able to do so by using a technology it introduced called a blockchain. And a blockchain can be understood as a data store stored in many different locations containing all transactions that have taken place so far in the system. And now for Bitcoin, these transactions were only monetary transactions, so how much money one person paid another person. But it didn't take very long before people realized that you could also store other types of information in there. In 2013, Vitalik Buterin published an academic paper about Ethereum. And Ethereum improved on the ideas of the Bitcoin by altering the blockchain so that it could store arbitrary information, and including programming code, so you could run programs on top of the blockchain system. Now, Buterin realized that you could use this to create decentralized computer programs, both financial in nature as well as computer games, and also to create voting applications to allow you to manage organizations in a decentralized or autonomous way. And he also realized that you could create value representations of many different kinds, and in this way transfer value or ownership of all kinds of things on the system without any centralized oversight. Now, this system is known as a blockchain network that executes smart contracts. That is what Ethereum at its core is. Of course, what exactly do these two terms mean? Well, that is what I'm now going to explain next. A blockchain network is a group of nodes that are able to talk to each other over the internet. And a node is a piece of software that anyone who wants to join can run on their own computer. Now, this network as a whole is used to store information and of course also transfer information from one place to another. And every one of these nodes, of these software instances, manages a complete copy of the blockchain. So every node knows everything that has happened so far. And this is important because this is the property that allows every node to validate what someone tries to do or execute and check if that is indeed allowed. And this is what allows the system to be run without any centralized oversight. Now, on top of this blockchain network, on Ethereum, we're able to execute what is known as smart contracts. And they can be understood as pieces of programmer code or program code that lives on top of the Ethereum blockchain. Now, a smart contract basically consists of two parts. It might contain a couple of data fields, which are basically containers that might contain a little bit of information. And what exactly, what type or what value is stored in there might actually change while time goes on. And the smart contract might also contain a couple of functions that read the values that are currently stored in the data fields or alter what value is stored in there. Now, it's important to note that a smart contract, once published to the blockchain, can never be altered anymore. While you are able to change what value is stored inside the data fields, you're only allowed to do this using the functions that the current computer code provides. And the actual code itself can never be altered anymore. This means that if you've made a mistake in your code, there's no way to fix this later on. And this is why smart contract development is very, very difficult to do properly, but also why it is an extremely exciting subject. Now, when you've published a smart contract, you can interact with it by communicating with it through your locally running node software. Of course, you can also communicate with a node that runs on someone else's computer, but in this case, you have to completely trust that that computer gives you valid information at all times. Now, a smart contract itself is very rudimentary in the types of values it is able to store and the type of information it gives you back. And also, it is rather slow. You often have to wait a long time before, and with a long time, I mean a couple of seconds up to a couple of minutes, before you receive confirmation of some change you've made. And this means that to actually create a program that's interesting to the user, you require to write some front-end software as well. Nowadays, there are some very interesting technologies, and we will go into more detail about this in some later episode, that allow you to create such a front-end program, which is often known also as a decentralized application, and store these in a way that is decentralized. All right. When we write a smart contract, then this is usually done using the Solidity programming language. And Solidity is usually stored as a text file with a .sol extension. Its syntax is very similar to the syntax of JavaScript, but rather than being dynamically typed, as JavaScript is, it is strongly typed. And what that means exactly is something we will explore in one or two episodes down the line. Now, sometimes what Solidity does and doesn't do for you, or does support and does not support, can be quite counterintuitive or tricky to understand. And I will try to point these things out to you, because there are some mistakes to be made there. And most of these things happen because Solidity doesn't run on a normal computer, but rather it runs on top of a blockchain system. Now I will try to point these out whenever we encounter them, of course. That was it for this episode. Leave us a comment, like, subscribe, and ring the notification bell to know whenever new episodes appear. The Tokener Explains is a collaboration between The Tokener and Resilia. If you're interested in the latest cryptocurrency-related information and news, go to thetokener.com. And if you're building your own blockchain-related product and have some questions or would like some help, reach out to us at resilia.nl.